Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Parenting the Strong-Willed Child, the clinically proven 5-week program for parents of 2 to 6-year-olds by Rex Forehand, PhD, and Nicholas Long, PhD, narrated by Barry Abrams. The challenges of parenthood are daunting, but its rewards go to the core of what it means to be human: intimacy, growth, learning, and love. Carnegie Corporation. Preface. Parenting is one of the most difficult tasks that we as adults face. While most of us receive training for our occupations, we enter the world of parenting with little instruction or guidance. As a result, we use mainly trial and error in our attempts to be effective parents. Unfortunately, with a strong-willed child, there is little time for trial and error. You need effective parenting skills, and you need them now. The first 2 editions of this book were well received by parents with strong-willed children and by professionals who work with these parents and their children. Based on the feedback from parents and advances in research, we decided an updated and expanded version of Parenting the Strong-Willed Child was due. In this edition, we make a number of additions, including the following: information about recent research that demonstrates the effectiveness of this book, expanded information on how to implement the 5-week program for changing strong-willed behavior, information on topics such as the importance of play and family meals for a child's adjustment, updated information on topics such as ADHD and the influence of electronic media, information on teaching your child the skills necessary to become a good reader, information on a method to teach your child basic social skills, information on addressing behavior problems at preschool or school, updated information on internet sites and books for parents. We have also streamlined several chapters so they are more user-friendly. Perhaps almost as difficult as parenting a strong-willed child is writing a book about how to parent such a child. You have to believe that you know something that can help these parents through the difficult times. Fortunately, we have spent collectively more than 65, yes, 65 years developing and evaluating programs for parents of strong-willed children. From the research data we have systematically collected and the reports of the many parents with whom we have worked, we know that the skills we have taught parents have helped them improve their relationships with their children. These skills also have helped these parents decrease their children's problem behaviors associated with being strong-willed and enabled the children to capitalize on the positive aspects of their strong wills. Beyond our research and clinical work with parents and their strong-willed children, both of us bring to this book the experience of being a parent. This personal experience is no small part of what informs this book. We know that parenting is not easy under the best of conditions. We know the difficulties of applying the parenting skills taught in this book. We know the highs and lows of parenting. We have experienced it all on a personal level, and this has helped us be realistic in our advice about parenting. Since the first edition of this book, there has been controversy about the extent of a parent's influence on her children. In particular, Judith R. Harris, in her book, The Nurture Assumption, Why Children Turn Out the Way They Do, questions the importance of the role parenting plays on a child's mental and emotional development. In contrast, we noted in the second edition of this book that our view, as well as that of many other behavioral scientists, is that parents do make a difference. Since the second edition, many research studies have continued to support our view. As we discuss in chapters 1 and 3, there are many other influences on children's behaviors. Nevertheless, parents, particularly for young children, have a major influence. This edition of the book could not have been written without the diligent work of many people. Several people in particular stand out. Robert J. McMahon has served as a guiding light and a wonderful colleague in much of our efforts to understand, implement, and disseminate our parenting programs. He is the senior author of the clinical program, Helping the Noncompliant Child, Family-Based Treatment of Oppositional Behavior, Guilford Press, on which this book is based. With patience and constant encouragement, I re-night typed and retyped numerous versions of the manuscript. Without her, there would not be a revised and updated edition. We also want to express our appreciation to Fiona Sarn at McGraw-Hill for the support, encouragement, and feedback she provided. Her skills go far beyond those typically associated with being an editor. We also want to thank Nancy Hall, Judith McCarthy, and the other staff members at McGraw-Hill for their valuable contributions. As you will hear throughout this book, the support, love, and learning that come from a family should never be underestimated. This is certainly the case for both authors. Since the first and second editions of this book, our children have grown up, and one is a parent herself. We have learned more from our children, as well as from our spouses and parents, about parenting since the first two editions. However, we believe our comments of thanks from the first edition still apply. Thus, we are pleased to repeat them here. Introduction. Parents of young, strong-willed children are frustrated. They are frustrated by their children's behavior, as well as the lack of support and resources to help them deal with their strong-willed children. If you are one of these parents, you are not alone. Most important, there is a strategy for dealing with the negative aspects of your child's strong-willed behavior. We have spent years developing, evaluating, and using a clinical treatment program that addresses the behavior problems often seen in young children who are very strong-willed, especially problems of not obeying their parents. We developed this program to help parents of these children, focusing on teaching parents techniques that they can use to improve their children's behavior. Over the past 40 years, we and many other researchers around the country have studied this clinical program, and the research has shown the program to be highly effective. Typical results for families who complete the program include improved parent-child relationships, more positive interactions between parent and child, children who mind their parents more, and fewer child behavior problems at home, and sometimes in other settings, such as preschool. Researchers who have done follow-up studies of children up to 15 years after completion of the clinical program have found the positive results to be lasting. Because this program is so effective, we have written about it in many professional journals and books. We also have taught the program's parenting techniques to psychologists and other professionals around the country so that they can use it with the parents with whom they work. We are committed to helping as many families as possible. That is why we decided to initially write and again revise this book for parents. Parenting the Strong-Willed Child covers most of the parenting techniques included in our clinical program. We believe that many parents can learn these clinically proven techniques by listening to this book and following its recommendations and exercises. If you use these parenting techniques correctly, they will improve your relationship with your child and reduce many of the problems associated with your child's strong-willed behavior. Two published studies provide support for our conclusion that listening to this book can change your child's strong-willed behaviors. In an independent research study, Dr. Nicola Connors at the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences and her collaborators found that participation in a parenting group that used Parenting the Strong-Willed Child as the curriculum was associated with less parenting stress, use of more effective parenting behaviors, and fewer child behavior problems. And, more directly related to you listening to this book, the two authors and two of our colleagues, Mary Jane Merchant and Emily Garai, found that parents who listened to Parenting the Strong-Willed Child reported significant decreases in their child's behavior problems. For specific strong-willed behaviors, these parents reported significantly greater decreases than did parents who hear a more general parenting book on understanding 3 to 6-year-old children and their development. However, Parenting the Strong-Willed Child was more effective only if parents reported hearing most or all of the chapters on implementing the 5-week program, chapters 5 through 11. Not surprisingly, This means you must actually listen to this book if you expect to change your strong-willed child's behavior. We also should note that parenting the strong-willed child has received the Association for Behavioral and Cognitive Therapy's Book of Merit Award. The award is given for educating the general public about the benefits of psychological treatments that have been proven to work. The 5-week program described in this book can improve your child's behavior. While this book is based on our clinical program, it is not a substitute for individual professional help if your child has severe behavior problems or if he might have a disorder such as hyperactivity, officially known as Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder. Refer to Chapter 4, Does My Child Have ADHD? If your child is exhibiting severe problems, we recommend that you consult your child's physician or a mental health professional for evaluation and assistance. The Association for Behavioral and Cognitive Therapies, ABCT.org, can help you find a therapist. However, even for many of the families that need professional guidance, we believe that the techniques presented in this book can be helpful as a supplement. Overview of the book. Our strategy for addressing strong-willed behavior has 3 dimensions. The first dimension involves helping you understand your child's strong-willed behavior and how various factors influence such behavior. The second utilizes specific parenting techniques for addressing the behavior problems most commonly exhibited by strong-willed children who are 2 to 6 years old. The third seeks to help you foster a strong foundation within your family and home that will make these parenting techniques most effective. When combined, these 3 dimensions form a holistic strategy you can use to understand your child's behavior and to learn how to change it. The book is divided into 4 parts. Each of the first 3 parts describes a different dimension of our strategy for parenting. The 4th part describes how to combine what you have learned from the previous 3 parts, along with other practical suggestions, to manage specific behavior problems. Part 1 explains the factors that cause or contribute to your child's strong-willed behavior. We start by examining the role of temperament in setting the stage for strong-willed behavior. We then address how your reactions to your child's behavior can affect and sometimes actually increase this behavior. We then go on to consider how factors such as conflict with your spouse or ex-spouse, divorce, your mood, alcohol abuse, and electronic media affect a child's behavior. Finally, as parents often have difficulty differentiating strong-willed behavior from attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, we end this part with a chapter addressing this issue. The parenting techniques in Part 2 take the form of a 5-week program for dealing with the behavior problems associated with a child being strong-willed. You will learn and practice a new skill every week. By the end of the 5 weeks, you should notice a significant improvement in your relationship with your child and in your child's behavior. In Part 3, we focus on ways to develop a more positive atmosphere in your family and home. The purpose of this part is to enhance and maintain the positive behavior changes that occurred as a result of the 5-week program. The chapters in this part explain how you can improve your family life, improve your communication skills, develop greater patience in dealing with your child, boost your child's self-esteem, and teach your child basic social skills. Part 4 offers strategies for managing specific behavior problems commonly reported by parents of young strong-willed children. Each problem is addressed separately, and the recommendations supplement the parenting skills discussed in Parts 2 and 3. Since Parenting the Strong-Willed Child was first published, the role of ethnicity or race in parenting has been more thoroughly studied. The studies that have appeared suggest that a parent's cultural background does affect her beliefs about parenting and child behavior, as well as parenting itself. However, strong-willed child behavior and parenting difficulties appear to exist in families of most ethnic groups. Furthermore, the same parenting techniques, those presented in this book, are effective for parents of most ethnic groups. You may need to adapt them slightly based on your cultural background, but the basic principles of the program are effective in parenting most strong-willed children. In a similar way, research on the father's role in the family has increased in recent years. In some families, fathers may use parenting skills at different levels or intensities than mothers. However, what is most important is for fathers to be actively involved in parenting, and, to the extent possible, for mothers and fathers' parenting to be consistent. When possible, both parents should hear this book and work together to change their strong-willed child's behavior. If this is not possible, this approach can still be effective when used by a single parent. We hope that this book will help you understand your strong-willed child's behavior, learn effective parenting skills, and learn how to enhance and maintain these parenting skills. We hope that learning how to use these skills, along with other recommendations that we offer to effectively address your major concerns regarding your child's behavior, will in turn increase your sense of competence as a parent. Author's note: in referring to children, we decided to use masculine pronouns for ease and clarity, not to imply that girls cannot be as strong-willed as boys. For the same reasons of convenience, we use primarily feminine pronouns when referring to parents. Part 1. Understanding Your Strong-Willed Child's Behavior. As parents, we can do a better job of addressing strong-willed behavior if we understand what it is and where it comes from. If you understand what factors contribute to your child's behavior, you will be better able to make the changes needed to address undesirable behavior. In Part 1, we give our views on the role of temperament in determining your child's behavior, Chapter 1, how your responses to your child's behavior can actually increase his strong-willed behavior, Chapter 2, how various factors within and outside the family affect your child's behavior, Chapter 3, and how you can tell the difference between strong-willed behavior and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, Chapter 4. 1. Strong-willed behavior and how it all begins. He was born with a strong will. That was what Tommy's parents told us when he was 2 years old. Several hours after Tommy was born, they said, the hospital nurses told them how fussy he was. Tommy cried and cried and cried. His parents thought it was colic and that his crying would decrease as he grew older. Unfortunately, as the months passed, the crying and fussing continued. By 18 months, he was always fussing and crying to get his way or to show he did not like something. He would fuss and cry when he had to take a bath or get dressed. Going to bed and getting up led to more fussing. It was not pleasant. 4-year-old Johnny was very outgoing and independent. Unfortunately, he was also very demanding. His parents and his preschool teacher stated that he was as stubborn as they come. If he did not get his way, Johnny would become upset and have temper tantrums. These tantrums included yelling, crying, and stomping his feet. Johnny was also very active and intense. He was always on the go and filled with boundless energy. As a result of his activity level, he often fell down. Although he rarely hurt himself, he would scream and act as if he had been mortally wounded. Mary was a 6-year-old kindergartner. Testing at school indicated that she had above-average intelligence and academic skills. She was also very confident and would persevere in challenging activities long after most other children gave up. Mary had never minded her parents very well, but did follow her teacher's instructions at preschool. Unfortunately, when she went to first grade, Mary began not minding at school. At first, Mary would just ignore instructions her teacher gave her. Then, she became openly defiant, saying, "No, I will not do it," in response to instructions from her teacher. Mary's parents were concerned that her behavior would affect her future education. What is strong-willed behavior? The parents of Tommy, Johnny, and Mary all considered their child to be strong-willed. But what does being strong-willed really mean? From our experience, these children usually have a very strong sense of independence. In many ways, this is very positive because individuals who are independent are typically also assertive, confident, determined, and persistent. Unfortunately, a strong sense of independence also frequently leads these young children to become stubborn, argumentative, and defiant. To see whether parents agreed with our view of the characteristics associated with being a strong-willed child, we conducted a survey. We asked a group of parents of 2 to 6-year-old children who were enrolled in a parenting class to tell us whether or not their child was strong-willed and what they believed were the characteristics of being strong-willed. An amazing 48% of the parents reported that their young child was strong-willed. A strong-willed child can be very frustrating and challenging to a parent, as you probably well know. However, both positive and negative qualities are associated with being strong-willed. The key is to nurture your strong-willed child's positive qualities while minimizing the impact of the negative qualities on him and on others. If you are like most parents of strong-willed children, your child's strong will may continually conflict with what you as his parent believe is best for him and your family. If this is the case, you will need to work with him to direct his strong will in more positive ways. The purpose of this book is to help you do this. You will decrease the negative aspects of your child's strong will while encouraging him to use it in positive ways. We hope that your child will learn to use his strong will to excel in life. In the beginning, there was temperament. How does a child become strong-willed? Many of the characteristics of being strong-willed have their roots in a child's temperament. As you will hear in chapters 2 and 3, a child's temperament lays the groundwork for his behavior and then interacts with a number of factors, particularly parenting, to lead to behavior that can be labeled strong-willed. This chapter will focus on helping you understand temperament and its relationship to the behavior of children and their parents. Temperament generally refers to a child's inborn behavioral style or innate tendencies to act a certain way. Temperament is reflected in how a child typically approaches, interacts in, and experiences social relationships. Imagine 2 15-month-old children who fall down while running across a lawn. Neither child is injured, but one child screams and cries following the fall. The other child laughs after he falls, gets up, and starts to run again. The different ways these children handle the fall reflect, in part, their temperaments. Temperament is generally considered to be something with which you were born. Many professionals believe that a child's basic temperament can be seen in early infancy, well before a particular parenting style has had time to have a major impact on his behavior. However, as we will show you later, your child's actual behavior, for example, what he does when told no, is a function of both his temperament and your parenting. Is your child strong-willed? If your child is strong-willed, you probably have known it since he was a baby. These are the children who feel their wants and needs strongly, and they let you know just how they feel. A group of parents in a parenting class described their own strong-willed children in the following terms. If she doesn't want to do something, there is no way you can make her do it. Always wanting to do everything for herself. Demands constant attention. Always wanting to make the decisions, choices. Not recognizing authority of adults, parents. Persistent. Unpredictable. Stubborn. Independent. Determined. Temperamental. Bad temper. Talks back a lot. Overly sensitive. Frequent temper tantrums. Negative reactions. Everything is a fight or a struggle. Won't mind. Resists direction. Doesn't respond to discipline. Knows no limits. Tells us what to do. Very outgoing. resists anything done to him, diaper changes, bath, dressing, etc. Headstrong, argumentative, aggressive, often upset, dominant, confident, questioning, assertive, completes a task in her own way, even if you show an easier way the task can be completed, cries to get her way constantly, her way or no way, no matter what, argues every point, pushes things to the extreme, works on a frustrating task, one that may be over his age level, until completed, will focus on one thing and be persistent until she gets what she wants, has own ideas, resistant to change. Do any of these descriptions sound like your child? If so, you have a lot of company. Researchers have identified numerous temperamental traits. A child's overall temperament is the combination of these individual traits. While there is not a pure, strong-willed temperament, there are several traits that are seen in many strong-willed children. These temperamental traits include reactivity, how intensely a child reacts, either positively or negatively, to different situations or events, adaptability, how well a child adapts to changes in situations and events, persistence, how long a child stays with an activity, and emotionality, the stability and the positive-negative aspects of a child's mood or emotions. Strong-willed children are more likely than other children to react intensely, to have a difficult time adapting to transitions, to be persistent when they want to have their own way, and to have inconsistent moods. In summary, there are several specific temperamental traits that we frequently observe in strong-willed children. This observation leads to the next question. Are these early temperament traits associated with later behavior problems? According to a number of research studies, a child's early temperament is significantly related to his later behavior. For example, infants and toddlers who are more irritable, restless, and have trouble adapting to new situations tend to have more behavior problems as they get older. Studies have found that difficult temperament in toddlers is strongly related to aggression and behavior problems from at least ages 3 through 12. A child's early temperament has been linked not only to later behavior problems, but also to later issues in other areas, including peer relationships, preschool adjustment, and even academic achievement. However, as we will discuss next, most of these same studies indicate that temperament cannot explain the whole story about a child's behavior. Temperament, parenting, and behavior. Many parents ask us whether it is their child's temperament or their parenting that has caused their child's strong-willed behavior. Such a question is like the often debated question of whether nature or nurture is most important in determining our personality. Since temperament and parenting continually interact, we seldom can know which is more important in determining a child's strong-willed behavior. It is interesting to note that several recent research studies have found that children with difficult temperaments are more affected by parenting practices than children with average or easy temperaments. So, you can make a difference in your child's strong-willed behavior. What is clear is that temperament and parenting are both important and clearly linked. Research suggests that many of the temperament traits we have been discussing can change as a child develops. That is, many of these temperament traits are not biologically fixed, but rather are tendencies that can be modified by parenting style and other environmental factors. As we will discuss in Chapter 2, we believe that strong-willed children typically have certain temperamental traits that lead to certain parenting practices. These practices, in turn, often strengthen the very strong-willed behaviors that parents want to decrease. This is good news because it means your strong-willed child's behavior is not biologically fixed by his temperament. You can influence your child's behavior through your parenting practices. Our 5-week program for parents, part 2 of this book, lays out parenting practices that will decrease the likelihood of later behavior problems in children with difficult temperaments. In summary, strong-willed behavior is common among young children and often has its roots in a child's early temperament. However, you can change the negative aspects of your child's strong-willed behavior through your parenting. In fact, that's probably why you bought this book. 2. Why is my child becoming even more strong-willed? The evidence suggests that many children are born with a strong-willed disposition, and this is not necessarily good or bad. However, a young, strong-willed child is more likely to engage in more of the negative behaviors we associate with a strong will, such as stubbornness, impatience, and tantrums. When that happens, strong-willed behavior becomes a problem, and a key factor that determines whether the child's behavior becomes more problematic is the way the parents manage the behavior. If your child's behavior is becoming worse, don't simply blame yourself. The way you have been responding to your child's behavior has been, in part, a function of his behavior. Unfortunately, strong-willed children often bring out the worst in parents. Responding in a positive way to a child who has an easy temperament is relatively easy. In contrast, when faced with the frustrations of dealing with a strong-willed child, parents are much more likely to use less than ideal parenting strategies. The focus of this chapter is how your child's behavior affects the way you respond to it and how your response in turn affects his behavior. We will start by discussing ways children learn to behave through their interactions with others. Our goal is to give you a basic understanding of how a child's behavior develops as a result of the environment in which he lives. This will help you analyze and solve the problem behaviors of your strong-willed child. Learning through social interactions. Much of how a child behaves is learned from interactions with others, which has been termed social learning. Temperament and other factors lay the groundwork, but it is through social learning that children establish most specific behaviors, both appropriate and inappropriate. Social learning occurs in three major ways: through modeling, reinforcement, and punishment. Modeling. This aspect of social learning is basically learning by example. Modeling occurs when a child learns how to behave a certain way by observing others behaving that way. Your child may see another child having a tantrum because the child wants a cookie. If the other child receives the cookie after the tantrum, your child learns by observation that a tantrum may be an effective way to get something. The next time your child wants something, he is more likely to have a tantrum. Observing someone behave in a certain way does not mean your child will automatically behave that way, but it does increase the chances that he might. Whether your child will imitate someone depends on many things, including whether he wants to be like that other person, how many times he observes the behavior, and whether the behavior observed had a positive outcome, like the child receiving the cookie to stop the tantrum. Modeling is a very important and powerful way of learning. You need to make sure that the behavior you model for your child is appropriate. Since young children look up to their parents, they are especially likely to behave like their parents do. For example, losing your temper in front of your child when you become frustrated increases the chance that your child will handle frustration in a similar way. Children often look to their parents for examples of how to behave in difficult situations. The philosophy, "Do as I say, not as I do," does not work. Modeling is more powerful than words in teaching children how to behave. Set a good example for your child. If you are strong-willed yourself, try to model the positive behaviors associated with being strong-willed, not the negative ones. For example, when you are upset with someone, try to model appropriate assertiveness, not aggressiveness. Model persistence when you face challenging tasks. Let your child see you keep doing something difficult until you are successful. Reinforcement. When most people think of reinforcement, they tend to think of giving children things like candy or money for good behavior. Such an understanding is immensely oversimplified and does not do the principle justice. Although many people resist the notion, reinforcement guides much of our behavior. In fact, it is a major key to the development of our child's behavior. The principle of reinforcement is simply that if a behavior is followed by something positive, the behavior is more likely to occur in the future. We are not saying a child's social behavior is primarily guided by someone's giving him material things whenever he behaves in certain ways. Most reinforcers are social in nature. These social reinforcers, attention, smiles, laughter, and so on, have the greatest impact on your behavior and on your child's behavior. Much of your child's behavior is gradually established through social reinforcers that occur over and over again each day. No single reinforcer will have a dramatic impact on behavior. Reinforcers work slowly and have to occur repeatedly in order to really change a person's behavior. Think about situations in your life in which social reinforcers guide your behavior. For example, you are more likely to talk to someone who smiles at you as you approach her than to someone who looks away. This is usually because your past experiences have been positive when you talk to individuals who smiled at you. Similarly, you probably spend more time talking to someone who gives you attention and makes you laugh. Your talking is being reinforced by the attention and laughing. In the same way, your child is reinforced more by little but frequently occurring responses to him, such as a touch, a smile, a compliment, a positive glance, or a word of encouragement, than by material rewards such as toys, candy, or money. A parent who gives a lot of social reinforcement to her child tends to receive a lot of social reinforcement from her child in return. One mother who went through our clinical program told us, "When I started smiling more at my child, he started to smile more at me. It made me feel so good." Another kind of reinforcement is negative reinforcement. Many people confuse negative reinforcement with punishment, but they are not the same. Negative reinforcement, like positive reinforcement, strengthens behavior. However, in negative reinforcement, a behavior is reinforced not because it results in something positive, but because it results in the removal or end of something negative. Suppose your child is playing in a sandbox. Another child begins throwing sand, which blows into your child's face. Your child goes over to the other child and assertively says, "Stop throwing the sand." If the other child stops throwing the sand, your child's assertiveness will have been negatively reinforced. That is, your child's assertiveness was followed by the end of something negative, blowing sand. Your child's assertiveness is strengthened, and he is more likely to be assertive in the future. Negative reinforcement can be difficult to fully understand, but it is important. It can play a major role in the development of disruptive behavior, as we will discuss later in this chapter. Punishment. Whereas reinforcement strengthens behavior, punishment weakens behavior. In the minds of many parents, punishment means spanking. However, spanking is only one type of punishment, and as research shows, not a particularly good type when long-term outcomes are considered. Punishment includes timeouts, reprimands, and removal of privileges. Anything that follows a behavior and weakens it is punishment. Although a single punishment rarely leads to any long-term changes in behavior, punishment can be effective if used correctly and consistently. However, relying too much on punishment has the following drawbacks. Punishment gives a child the message of what not to do without necessarily teaching what to do. To maintain the effectiveness of punishment, parents often have to use increasingly harsher punishment. If punishment becomes significantly more frequent and intense over time, it can lead to problems such as child abuse. With frequent punishment, a child may resent his parent and become aggressive toward her. Individuals who give a lot of punishment tend to receive a lot of punishment in return. As with reinforcement, you tend to receive what you give. For example, parents who use excessive punishment frequently find themselves on the receiving end of their child's anger. In summary, using some types of punishment, such as timeout, sparingly, and along with a lot of reinforcement for positive behavior, can be effective. However, excessive use of punishment may create more problems than it solves. Accidentally reinforcing your child's inappropriate behavior. Although much of your child's social learning takes place through reinforcement, you may often provide the reinforcement without being aware of it. This unintended reinforcement occurs naturally within everyday interactions. Unfortunately, you often end up reinforcing the exact behaviors you were trying to eliminate. Sometimes, a parent inadvertently rewards her child's inappropriate behavior. For example, when you are shopping with your child, he sees a toy he wants. He starts to cry and whine. You try to comfort and calm him. Still whining and crying, he asks you again for the toy. You hate to see him upset, or you are embarrassed by his behavior, so you agree to buy the toy for him. What has happened in this interaction? You rewarded your child for crying and fussing by providing attention and comfort, as well as by purchasing the toy. What has your child learned? He has learned that he can sometimes get your attention and what he wants by crying and fussing. The next time he wants something, what is he more likely to do? Cry and whine in an effort to get what he wants. We call this the positive reinforcement trap. We as parents reinforce and increase the likelihood of the very behavior we want to decrease. To better understand this concept, refer to additional examples in Are You Rewarding the Behaviors You Don't Like? A single incident like the preceding example will not permanently affect your child's behavior. However, when this type of interaction occurs repeatedly, it can lead to an escalation of crying, fussing, or other inappropriate behaviors. Since you surely don't want to reward your child's inappropriate behavior, analyze your own behavior. Are you unintentionally rewarding your child's inappropriate behavior? If so, try to stop. If you find it extremely difficult to stop, do not be surprised. Old habits are hard to change. The parenting program presented in Part 2 will help you escape the positive reinforcement trap. Children also learn to misbehave in order to avoid something they do not like. For example, you tell your child to pick up the toys that he's left on the floor. He does not pick them up, so you start reminding him over and over. Out of frustration, you resort to nagging. As you are nagging him, he turns to you, starts to cry, and calls you mean as he runs to his room. You decide that it's just not worth the frustration to make him pick up the toys. You pick up the toys and put them away. What happened in this situation? Well, your child learned that by crying, calling you a name, and running away from you, he made you stop the nagging and he did not have to pick up the toys. This is an example of the negative reinforcement trap. As with the positive reinforcement trap, this trap reinforces and increases the likelihood of the behavior a parent wants to decrease. More examples are given in Are You Rewarding the Behaviors You Don't Like? To help you understand the negative reinforcement trap. Are you rewarding the behaviors you don't like? In spite of our best intentions as parents, we often reinforce the very behaviors we most want to end. Have you ever responded to your child's behavior in any of the following ways? Repeatedly responding to your child's calls after he has gone to bed. comforting your child when he has a tantrum, giving attention to your child each time he interrupts your conversation with another adult, laughing at your child's inappropriate behavior, giving your child candy in the grocery store when he starts crying, letting your child sleep with you every night just because he begs to do so. If you have done these things, you have fallen into the positive reinforcement trap. You are encouraging the inappropriate behavior by rewarding it with attention, comfort, laughter, and so on. Many parents also fall prey to the negative reinforcement trap. Do any of these actions sound familiar? Letting your child skip his bath because he cries when you say bath time. Telling your child to get out of the bathtub, but because he cries, letting him stay in longer. Letting your child leave an event because he begs not to stay and has a tantrum. Canceling the babysitter because your child cries when you tell him you are going out. Telling your child to sit quietly at the dinner table, but because he has a tantrum, letting him leave the table. Taking your child out of his car seat because he cries to get out. These responses to negative behavior reinforce the behavior by ending something your child perceived as unpleasant, such as taking a bath or having a babysitter. Fortunately, there is an escape from both of these traps. The details are in part two. Just as with the positive reinforcement trap, a single incident involving negative reinforcement will not permanently affect your child's behavior. However, when this type of interaction occurs repeatedly, it can lead to a significant escalation in inappropriate behaviors. The coercive process. A negative reinforcement trap rarely occurs in isolation. Complex interactions between a parent and child often involve both individuals falling into the negative reinforcement trap. Gerald Patterson, an internationally renowned researcher at the Oregon Social Learning Center, has studied this phenomenon extensively and has identified what he calls the coercive process. This process occurs in many families with a young child who is strong-willed. The coercive process can occur repeatedly during the hundreds of interactions between a parent and child each week. As a result, a child's behavior and the parent's management of the behavior gradually become more and more negative as each person's behavior receives frequent negative reinforcement. As an example of the coercive process, imagine you take your child to a store and tell him to hold your hand. He does not want to hold your hand, so he starts whining and trying to pull away to escape your grasp. Out of frustration, you eventually give up and let go of his hand so that you do not have to deal with his fussiness and constant tugging. In this situation, his fussing and resistance to your direction to hold your hand were negatively reinforced by your giving in to him. But your giving in also was negatively reinforced because it stopped his fussing and resistance. As a result of this interaction, your child will more likely resist you and fuss to get his way in the future. And you will more likely give in to his resistance and fussiness because by giving in before, you stop the problems in the short run. Now, let's add a different twist to the same example. In this case, when your child whines and physically resists holding your hand, you raise your voice and tell him he has to hold your hand. The resistance continues and, in fact, becomes worse. You lose your temper and start yelling at him. He stops resisting. In this case, your yelling was negatively reinforced because it stopped the resistance. This will increase the chances that you will yell at him again in the future. With the coercive processes described here, a child's behavior gradually becomes more negative, and a parent's response to the negative behavior gradually becomes more severe. For example, your child's temper tantrums or other negative behaviors might become more intense and frequent, while at the same time, you start to yell or spank more intensely or frequently. This downward cycle will continue as you are each reinforced for use of increasingly negative behavior. How are you reinforced? By the termination of the other person's negative behavior. The coercive process is difficult to grasp all at once. However, we hope you can appreciate that the way you manage your child's behavior can play a significant role in the development of later problems. The way you behave influences his behavior now, and also the way you will manage his behavior in the future. This effect occurs not as a result of isolated incidents, but through an ongoing series of complex interactions between a parent and a child. Other factors that contribute to strong-willed behavior problems. Besides the positive reinforcement trap and the negative reinforcement trap, which escalates in the coercive process, several other factors may lead to your child's becoming increasingly strong-willed. Parents who have children with behavior problems tend to pay less attention to their child's positive behaviors. These parents become so frustrated in having to deal with their child's negative behaviors that they have a hard time noticing and acknowledging the behaviors that are positive. As the parent of a strong-willed child, you need to make an extra effort to acknowledge and praise your child's positive behaviors. Make sure you let your child know that you notice the times he does do what you tell him. We will discuss this issue in greater detail in parts 2 and 3. Parents of strong-willed children also are often uncertain how to manage their child's disruptive behavior. This uncertainty can result in an inconsistent pattern of discipline. A parent who feels overwhelmed and questions her ability to manage her child's disruptive behavior may withdraw from the situation and not intervene at all. At other times, she may become frustrated and resort to overly aggressive ways of managing her child's disruptive behavior. For example, losing her temper and yelling or spanking. Neither an overly permissive nor an aggressive parenting style is very effective. In fact, these styles tend to escalate behavior problems, especially when used inconsistently. The 5-week parenting program presented in Part 2 can help you become a more positive and consistent parent. Modeling is one of the most powerful forms of teaching both positive and negative behaviors. If your strong-willed child is frequently around other children who often misbehave, he may start to copy their negative behaviors. This will be especially true if your child does not observe an adult effectively managing the other children's misbehavior. Take charge and create an environment that is positive for your child. Arrange play situations with friends who do not feed your child's negative behavior. Try to encourage him to interact with children who are generally well-behaved. Just like bad behavior, good behavior will rub off. Children also model the behavior of their parents, as we discussed earlier in this chapter. If you frequently yell when frustrated, your child will learn to yell when he becomes frustrated. If you hit when angry, your child will learn to hit when he becomes angry. On the positive side, if you model appropriate behavior, your child likely will behave more appropriately. When you become frustrated or angry, try to stay calm and model appropriate ways of handling the situation. The important point is to remember to set a good example for your child. The negative behaviors we associate with being strong-willed may become more pronounced if your child does not get enough sleep. Tired children often are fussy. The fussiness can trigger the negative interactions associated with the coercive process. As a result, the fussiness may contribute to behavior problems as the parent and child become increasingly negative with one another. If your child is not getting enough sleep, there are several things that you can do. For some suggestions, refer to Part 4. Reasons children become increasingly strong-willed. Positive reinforcement trap. Negative reinforcement trap. Coercive process. Repeated negative reinforcement traps set by parent and child. Child receives little attention for positive behavior. Parent is inconsistent in response to behavior problems. Child's peers model inappropriate behavior. Parents model inappropriate behavior.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.